It's a great pleasure to have today Davide Gabrieli from the University of L'Aquila. And you see his title is on the screen. So thank you very much, Davide, for accepting to give a talk in our seminar.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a pleasure to speak at IMPA. And so, okay, this is a talk based on two papers. So one it's on the archive, and the other one I hope it will be soon. And so it's dealing with this problem of there is an object that is fluctuating. There are two parameters, and on this chain, the fact that the result is irrelevant on the order. But okay. Let us start from, so the general framework is this. I have a stochastic interacting particle system that is on a domain of RD. So this is the domain. And there is a lattice there that is an approximation of the domain. This is the notation for the edges. And the domain could be also a torus. In one of the models will be a torus. And this is the classical notation for the number of particles at a point x on the lattice at time t. So I will consider two different models, the exclusion, where on each side there could be one or zero particle, at most one, or the zero range, where you can have as many particles as you want. Sorry, I have to move this. Okay. Okay. And then I want to study, so I can have some boundary conditions that are so I use these arrows just to indicate a particle can exit and can be created at the boundary. And the question is a generic one. So what we can say about the current that is flowing to this system, through this system, and we can study the problem we are interested in the limit of large time, and in the limit of n that is going to plus infinity, so when the mesh of the lattice is going to zero. And I will discuss what happens if I do these things in the different order. Okay, so why is not going to stop it, sorry. Okay. This here. So let us define the current. So you have an edge of your lattice, and this is the number of particles that jumped from x to y in the time window of 0t. And this is associated to each edge that you have, is the difference between the jump in one direction and in the other, and this is the net current. So this is what is called a discrete vector field. So it is an object that is a function of on edges that is antisymmetric in the exchange of the order of the two vertices. So an example of the discrete vector field is indeed this current J. And another one that several times, it's a discretization of a smooth vector field. So you have a smooth vector field, and you take the line integral on an edge xy, and you are getting an object that is a discrete vector field, and by construction is of order 1 over n, since you are integrating something that is smooth on a curve that is has a length that is of order 1 over n. Sorry, I have some problems with a delay on the. Sorry. Okay, now it's working. Okay, this is okay. Sorry. So then let me define the object for which that are useful for the scaling limit. The first one is the empirical measure that is associated to configuration. So if you have a configuration, you associate this object here that is a positive measure on the domain, and this is just this convex combination of of delta measures with this weight that is given by the number of particles. So the integration with respect to a continuous function of the empirical measure is given by this sum here. Empirical caso. The empirical current, so this is the integrated empirical current. Now you have a trajectory, so that just a trajectory of your particle systems in the time window zero t, and you associate to this what is called the integrated empirical current. So the notation is this, with this n is similar to this, that is the discrete vector field, but I think there will be no confusion. So they are very related object. So this is an object that can be integrated with respect to smooth vector field. So this object here is defined through the action of on a smooth vector field. So take F as smooth vector field on the domain. We define the integration of this empirical current with respect to the smooth vector field as this sum here. The one half here is that since I am summing on xy and yx, so I get twice, and these objects are too antisymmetric, I get twice the same things. And F is a smooth vector field and Fn is a discretization. So you have to think of this empirical integrated current as an object of a Sobolev space. So this is just for technical reasons, but you need just so you cannot imagine as a measure, but just you have in mind that this is the action on smooth vector field. So this is the definition. This is related to the topology and to have the tightness, the exponential tightness of the process, but I will not enter in these details. Okay, now it's working. So these two objects are the one that satisfied this discrete continuity equation. Take a smooth function f, then you have this equality that is true for any trajectory f. Then I want to discuss the fluctuation of this empirical current, and I will do so as I told you, we can study this in different regimes, and I will follow the historical perspective where it has been before studied in the limit where n is going to plus infinity and then t is going to plus infinity. In particular, I'm concentrating on particles model that are diffusive. So the example, in particular, the two examples on which I will concentrate are these two. So the weakly asymmetric exclusion process, where you have that the rate of jump of one particle from x to y is given by this rate here. So this is the external field A I discretize and gives me a kind of drift, and the n square in front is just due to is the diffusive rescaling of the system, that is the natural scaling of my system. So particles here are doing a symmetric round the walk, apart that they have this R-core interaction. And then you have a zero range interaction, a zero range model, another model where there is one particle is jumping from site X to site Y. So there is a jump of one particle from X to Y with a rate that is N squared. This is again the diffusive scaling, times this function g, that is a positive function and gives the interaction that, so particles are interacting just if they are on the same site. So these are the two models that I will study. And sorry, but I'm going to delay because I have a problem with the turning pages. I don't know why, it was working perfectly. So now you study the fluctuations. So t is fixed. There is this n squared that is multiplying the rates, and you study the fluctuation, the large deviations for these two objects. So this has been studied, this is what is the content of this macroscopic fluctuation theory that has been developed in the last years by these authors here. And this says essentially that the fluctuations of the current and of the density They are just determined by two objects that are the diffusion matrix, D of rho, and the mobility matrix. So these are, are called the transport coefficients and determine the fluctuations of the system. For the exclusion process, and also for the weakly asymmetric exclusion process, these two objects here, the diffusion matrix is the identity matrix, and the mobility is rho times 1 minus rho. So it's depending on the density rho times the identity. While for the zero range, you have that the diffusion, so they are related in this form here. And this is depending on the for the zero range is depending on the form of the function g. So first, before studying the fluctuations, let's go to the hydrodynamic limit. So take a trajectory on a finite window of eta t. Take an initial condition such that the empirical measure is converging to an absolutely continuous measure. So this is in the weak sense, rho zero x dx, that is determined by a density rho zero. Then the hydrodynamic limits say that at later times, you have that the empirical measure at times t is converging to a measure with a density that is a rho of t, is an evoluted density. And the current as a form of this type here, where this j star of rho is the typical current associated to the density rho. And the form is this. So rho and this, so rho and this j star of rho, they are related by the continuity equation. And j star of rho has this form here that is determined by the diffusion matrix and the mobility one. So if you put both together, if you use the two equations here, you discover that the rho is satisfying a nonlinear diffusion equation. But you have more, that the typical current that you observe, so this object here at time t is converging to this integral where here you have to put the rho, that is the solution of this nonlinear equation, with the initial condition that is rho zero. So for the large deviations on the hydrodynamics, again, the macroscopic flotation theory say that there is a very general form of the large deviation rate functional that has this form. So you take, again, t is fixed, the time is fixed, and you are interested in this in the probability that to observe a given profile rho t, jt of density and current, and every time that I'm writing a density and a current here with the empirical one or not the empirical one, they will be always related by the continuity equation. So you choose something that can be different from the typical solution of the hydrodynamic equation. You ask which is the exponentially small probability to observe a trajectory here. Then this probability is exponentially small with a rate function that is this, and has a general structure that is like this. So this sigma here is the mobility matrix. And so this is the case where the mobility and the diffusion matrix are multiple of the identity, but there is a similar structure also in other cases. And this J star, recall I cannot go up and down very quickly, I don't know why, but so this J star is the typical current, so it was here. Is this one. Okay. Okay. Now sometimes it's working, sometimes not. Is this one, so is the typical current that you have here, this expression here. And now we want to, so this is for n is going has gone to infinity and t is fixed. Now we want to send t to infinity and discover what happens. So, and the problem is this. So we want to study, so we are taking t that is going to plus infinity. We take on this time window, we take the integrated current up to type t, we divide by t, and we ask which is the probability that this object here is it's near to a given current J. So this is a recall that this is a Jn. So is the empirical entropy Jn n of t. Recall that is an object that is integrated, can be integrated on smooth vector fields. So you have to imagine like an object that has a density, a position dependence. So this is a kind of, so the, you can ask this for J that is a given fixed vector field. So J is J of X. Exponentially, when t is big, this probability is exponentially small with a rate that is t, and this phi of j that will be the main object of interest. So what happens is that here you can just ask that you can ask this a question like this only if j is divergence free, because otherwise, if j is not divergence free, then okay, if you are choosing here something that j that is not divergence free, and you observe this for a long time, since the divergence is dot zero, we'll have regions where the density is exploding, and this for the VASEP case cannot happen at all. For the zero range case, it's super exponentially small. So J will be divergence free, and in particular, if you are in one dimension, then J has to be just a constant. So historically, the first answer was given by Bodino and Derrida that were interested on this problem here. And let us discuss just in one dimension, but it's more general, the solution that they have. So they take just in one dimension. So here the current can be, for a long time, the average current can be just a constant because it has to be divergence free. And then they say that this functional phi of j that tells you the exponential rate on time to observe a given time average current, it will depends on the length of the interval and on the boundary condition that you have here. Because here I'm considering a generic system where particles are created at the boundaries and are created in such a way that the density at the boundary is fixed. So they say that from general argument, they say that there is an additivity principle. So that this phi, that is this functional here, if you cut the system in two subsystems, so you cut in L prime and you fix another density in L prime, then the total functional for the current is just the infimum. So is the best one about the density that you can fix on the cut L prime. So this is the additivity principle. And for a generic system, diffusive system, they deduce that if you have the additivity principle and you use some mild hypothesis, some generic hypothesis, then you are getting exactly the explicit form of this functional phi, that is this. So you have to minimize of all possible density profiles that take the value rho zero at the left boundary, take the values rho L on the right one, and you have to minimize this object here. Recall that this is the typical current. So for example, for the simple exclusion, J star of rho is minus the gradient of rho. And sigma of rho is the mobility. Okay, and this is the answer. Then the answer two was developed by in the macroscopic fluctuation theory and say that the additivity principle may fail and you can have a dynamical phase transition. So because in the framework of the macroscopic fluctuation theory, then what you have is that you have a space-time large deviation for the density and the current. So you have J and rho, you have a functional that takes care of the rho and J that are always related by the continuity equation on time. And then if you fix the time t and you want to observe a given average integrated current that is J here, then by the contraction principle, what you have to do, you have to minimize this rate function that is generic under such constraint. Then if you are interested in the limit for large t, you need to do a limit of the functional that you obtain here. And this is okay. Mathematically, this is a gamma limit. And this will give to you a rate functional that is governing the fluctuations of the current through the systems when you are sending before n to infinity to the dynamic limit, and then you study the system on a large window, so t is big. And then you see that the additivity principle of Bodinoid Derrida holds if and only if the minimizer that you have here are time independent. So now it's working. Because if the minimizer are time independent, and you go here, you take a J that is time independent, a rho that is time independent, since you are dividing by T, so this integral will be T times the minimum of this on the constraint that you have for the additivity principle, and you will get exactly the answer of the additivity principle. But no? So the additivity principle means only if the minimizer is something that is time independent. But then after this, so there was the question if it's possible to have a minimizer that is not time independent. And indeed, so this is the case. So for the general function that you have there, for example, if you take the VASEP with a field that is strong enough, this was showed by the Bodinoid Derrida, you can have that a traveling wave trial can be better than a constant one. And this is also true for the KMP, the Kiplis-Marchiori-Presutti model on a ring. So what is the situation? A traveling wave means that you take a given T, you take a density that is as the structure of a traveling wave, and also the current, this big F is a vector field. They have to be related by the continuity equation. The average of the current should be the J that you fixed. And then for such models, you can show that there is a traveling wave under some condition for which the cost that you pay to create this average on time current is so the cost is less than the one that you pay just taking the system cost. So essentially this means that if you want to observe an atypical current for such model there, so the cheapest way to produce this fluctuation to the system is not to choose the better profile rho and have this divergence free current all the times, but to produce this using a traveling wave. So this is not the optimal one. We can just prove that this is better than the constant one. Then, so historically after this arrived, so in at the same time indeed, because so Varadhan was just assisting to a talk of Claudio at, to a talk of Claudio, and just say that he was saying that okay, there should be a formula, a representation formula for this functional phi of j, that is the following. So this functional phi of j, that is the one that is determining the fluctuations for the current for large time after that you did the hydrodynamic limit, should be an infimum over probability measures of 1 over t, the average with respect to these probability measures of this functional here, that is the functional of the macroscopic fluctuation theory. And the infimum is of a probability measure p on the pairs rho and j that are related by the continuity equation. P are measures that are invariant, time invariant by the shift, and they are such that the average with respect to P of the time average current is exactly given to J. So this is a representation, and that say that this rate function should be obtained by this minimization over these probability measures. And since P is invariant by time shift, then so here I'm writing the T, but the result does not depend on T because P stays stationary. Okay. Okay. In a paper with Claudio and Lorenzo Bertini, we proved that indeed this is the case, and you obtain exactly the same formula even if you proceed in the different order. And indeed, we give also an interpretation to this formula. And since so at the end, so we do this for a specific model that is the weak asymmetric process model on a torus. And you, if you recall, this is a case where you may have a dynamic phase transition, so the minimizer can be not constant. And the interpretation is just that indeed this infimum that is this infimum that is here indeed is a is can be interpreted as a contraction principle for a large Bayesian rate function at an higher level. So what is this higher level large Bayesian principle is what is called level three large Bayesians. Well, let me see the time because I'm going, okay. And level three large Bayesian, this is discussed in a very general framework. This is called the, is one of the main result of Dosker and Varadhan is as follows. Take NT, that is a trajectory of your system. So an element of the scalar space taking values on configuration of particles. And then you define this object here. So this is a trajectory, but the original trajectory was on a finite time window. This trajectory here is on infinite time. And it is very simple, so the formula can be, so you have to think a bit, but the picture is that like this. In red, here you have the piece of the trajectory that you have with the a few jumps, and then this this trajectory here on the infinite line of time is just take this and periodize it. So you take the periodicity, you do periodically, and you extend to all the line of the time. Then starting from, so this is a trajectory of your system with on the infinite times. You can have, so you can have some technical problem when you, because you could have some jumps that are not a typical jump of the systems, but so you, let's avoid this, this technicality. And then you define the empirical process that is defined like this. So you just, take an average in time, tau of t is the time translation by t. So is a convex combination of delta measures. Each delta measure is concentrated on these infinite periodic paths, and they are shifted by a time t on the period big t. So is a uniform combination of this delta measure concentrated on infinite trajectory that you have. So this is the typical trajectory of the empirical process for the level three large Bayesians. So this is a probability measure, and it's a probability measure. So this construction is done in such a way that this probability measure is a probability measure that is invariant on the shift, is a probability measure on the paths like this. So it's a convex combination of infinite paths. So it's a probability measure on this corridor space here, and is invariant by the shift, since just by the construction. And the classical Dosker-Varadhan theorem states that so there is this large Bayesian rate function for this for the empirical process that has a general form, and recall that here we are keeping n fixed and we are sending n to infinity. So this is called, as I told you, is the Dosker-Varadhan, is one of the, so Dosker-Varadhan did the large Bayesian of this type when the time is big, the level one, level two, and level three. So this is the highest possible level large Bayesians. So n is fixed. And this is very general, and also very general, under very general hypothesis for a generic Markov process. The rate function of this object here is the relative entropy. So it is a rate function on probability measures on paths, because this is a random object here, it's a probability measure on paths. So the density of relative entropy is this. So this functional associated to this P is, let's say, the limit of the relative entropy on fixed windows where T is going to plus infinity. So you compute the relative entropy between the measure on paths restricted to a window, time window 0t, and then you divide by t and send t to plus infinity. So an important fact of this rate function that it's that it not for fixed t, but in the limit, this object here, it's affine. So it's really, so there is really an equality here. If you take a convex combination of probability measures here, so the density of a relative entropy is equal to the convex combinations of the relative entropies. So this is at level of the process. So now we want to go to the level. So we need to project to the current and to the density. So if you have a trajectory on the particles, so this is an element of the Skorodov space on the infinity line with values on the configurations. That is the one that we constructed in a periodic way before. Then you can apply the empirical measure and integrated empirical current for each time. Then starting from this, you obtain this object here. And these are elements of this product space. So they are Skorodov space, but the first object here, it's a measure. And the second object here is an object that is in this Sobolev space here, but is, so it's a kind of vector fields that act on vector fields, and that depends on the trajectory that you are choosing. And correspondingly, you can take the empirical process that I defined before. You compose with this projection, and you obtain this kind of empirical process that is projected on the physical space. So this is at least the intuition that I have. So I have to, and this object here is an element of this that is called p stat, that are the probability measures that are invariant by time translation and are probability measures on infinite paths on this space here. So the Donsker-Varadan rate function will be a kind of a contraction principle for a large evasion rate function here on this space of probability measures on infinite paths. No, it's not going. So recall that the large evasion rate function for the empirical process is just the density of relative entropy. And the rate function for this projected empirical process can be computed very easily by contraction by that one. And then, and we call like this, there is, so it's essentially the same rate function, just for n fixed. And then let us define a rate function that recognize is the one that is involved in the Varadan formula. So you define this function on this p stat that are stationary, called a stationary measure on these infinite paths that take values on measures and on vector fields, let's say. So the empirical measure and empirical current. And you take a functional that is affine functional, that is the one. You take a probability measure here, and then the value associated to this probability measure, E of P, is just this value here. That is exactly the formula that was appearing in the Varadan formula. So you see that so this is the expected value with respect to the probability P. So it is immediate that is it's affine. And again, I'm writing here T because, okay, just for because so I need this T to write in a meaningful way the rate function. But by stationarity, this is indeed independent on T, since P is a stationary measure. Then the result of with Claudio and Lorenzo is the following. So it's essentially a large evasion principle that is uniform on the initial condition, let me state at least formally. And it is like this. So here I'm writing like this. And when I'm writing lim sup, when n and t goes to plus infinity, this can be lim sup when n goes to infinity and lim sup when t goes to infinity, or lim sup when t goes to infinity and lim sup when n goes to infinity. So if you do these two limits in the order that you want, then you are getting that in the limit this upper and lower bound for the rate function that is this E of rho, that is E of p, that is the one that is appearing in the Varadhan form. And 30, okay, let me just discuss a bit the idea of how to prove this theorem. For example, just in the case where I'm sending before t to plus infinity and then n to infinity. Indeed, to prove a result of this type, for the case where you send before t to plus infinity and after you send n to infinity, you need just to prove that this rate function here, where this En was the rate function of large evasion for the empirical process projected on the physical space, is gamma convergent to this rate function I. How you proceed? Can be useful since you understand a possible origin of the dynamical phase transition. So this functional are fine. Then you need just to prove this convergence essentially for the ergodic measure. And using a density argument, indeed you can just prove this convergence for what are called holonomic measures. So the holonomic measures are done like this. Take PT, JT, an element that is here, and recall that they have to satisfy the continuity equation, that are T periodic for a given T. And then you construct a probability measure. So this is just a path here. And I want to construct a probability measure here that is invariant by the shift. How I do this? As I was doing this for the empirical process, I just do a convex combination of delta measures where I take this path that is T periodic, so is infinite, but T periodic, and I shift by a times that is S. So this average here, if you have a measure that can be written like this, so essentially is a delta measure concentrated on a periodic path, but since if you take this, this is not invariant by time translation, then you have to do this in a uniform way. So if you have a measure that is like this, then this measure is called holonomic. And what happens here? So that take an holonomic measure. So take an holonomic measure associated. So how to prove this convergence for holonomic measures? Take a periodic path like this and the corresponding holonomic measure. What I have to do, I construct Pn, that is a weakly symmetric exclusion process that has a suitable time periodic external field such that the hydrodynamic limit of this weakly symmetric model gives me as hydrodynamic exactly this periodic solution. Then I need to do this construction that is seems a bit complicated, but it's just take this measure and you need to project on the physical space with the empirical measure and empirical current, and you have to do in such a way that is stationary. And then you can prove that, so this is You can prove, and this is one of the part of the gamma convergence to prove the results, that you have the correct convergence of the value of the rate function computed on the embedding here to the value of this functional that is appearing on the Varadhan formula. So the message up to here is that the Varadhan formula, it's essentially a contraction principle from a higher level large deviation rate function that is at the level of probability measures, stationary probability measures on paths and on density and currents. Okay, so let me do just, I am in time. Let me just finish discussing another technique with which we can prove this invariance on the limit for another model, and this is for the zero range model, and this is so a paper that I hope it will be finished soon. It's indeed we have these results from several years, but we decided now to write it. And since, okay, we have a nice interpretation, so it's like this. So I'm doing in one dimension boundary driven zero range process just for simplicity, but it's much more general. And then again, so you have time and n that are the two parameters. I have the boundary driven zero range process, so particles here can exit and be destroyed and can enter and are inside the system. And I want to study the current that is flowing through the system. Okay, since we are interested in the limit n big and t big, as I said before, the current when t is big can only be divergence free, so has to be a constant. And then, so if we do before the limit the hydrodynamic limit, and then we send t to plus infinity, then for this model you can prove that the additivity principle is true. It holds and It works perfectly, and you can really solve the variational problem that is static one and find the final result. Then we want to study what we are doing here. We study n fixed and t goes to infinity. And this has been studied by other people with different techniques getting the same results. But here we are getting something, a structure that is interesting, because if we take n fixed and then send n to infinity, we have some variational, some of the variational computation, the relative n, so some problems that could be very similar to the one of the Varadhan formula for this simple model can be indeed solved, because you can restrict to zero range dynamics that are time homogeneous. So you have not this phenomenon of the dynamical phase transition. You can just restrict to zero range models that are time homogeneous. Then for n fixed, and t that is going to plus infinity, so you have the current that is flowing on this finite graph for t that is big, you can really solve explicitly the large deviation rate function, and you are getting an expression like this, so an exact expression that is the infimum on some parameter phi. At the boundary, this parameter are fixed by the alpha and beta. And this function here is related to the inverse hyperbolic sine that has this structure here. It's very simple. It's a function that is a kind of universal, is the rate function of the difference of two independent Poisson processes with parameter phi and phi prime. So you have just to minimize over phi. And indeed, it holds that you can do exactly this minimization. And indeed, the additivity principle is exact even for n finite, and it's followed by computation that are related to additivity formulas of this inverse hyperbolic sign. And you're getting that this sum here is just a kind of, so it's like you have a lot of contribution on different terms, and then you can substitute all of this term by one single one with some effective parameters. And it is exactly like this. So this minimization, this finite n additivity principle, indeed can be interpreted as some electrical net, a kind of electrical networks that also in a framework where you have not reversibility, and moreover, okay, you have not reversibility. So you have a kind of electric component that has a right conductivity, CL, and a left conductivity, CR. The phi can be interpreted as potentials that you apply at the two extremes. And you can imagine that, so you have an electric component that has this conductivity, and if you apply these two potentials at the boundaries, you have a kind of energy dissipated that is given by this function if the current that is flowing is J. Okay. It's a parallel with the electrical network, because for the typical current, this will be zero. So let's say that if you have the typical current, you have no dissipation of energy. Or otherwise, if you have a typical current, you pay a price that is given by this. Okay, then, so in the formula that you have here, you have a sum of all the energy dissipated by the several components, and you say that this is just one single energy dissipated by one single effective component. And this is exactly, so the is like this. Because, so indeed, for this function here, you have a kind of, you have a rules for reducing, you can have a very general network where you are creating particles, for example, on nodes, and on another nodes, and you want to observe the current that is flowing through these systems, okay, then you can get this large deviation rate function just reducing your network with these rules. So you have, if you have two of these electric components that have a left and right conductivity that are in series, you can substitute this by one single electric component where there is an effective left conductivity and an effective right conductivity that are given like this. So this is also in a non-reversible framework. So it's the order here. So if I put the second component on the right and on the left, it matters in these final formulas here. And if you have in parallel, then you can substitute these two in parallel with one single component that has this left and right conductivity that are summed, can be summed. And finishing here, I think that I'm in time. And so here you can do, since you can solve exactly in all the cases, you can do the limit in the two different orders, and you are getting the same function, phi of j, that is the same. And this was obtained also by other things, but so, in this model, in this approach here, I think what is interesting is this kind of telescopic behavior and this kind of effective this substitution of this kind of electrical network structure. Okay, sorry, I don't know why, but I had some problems so in turning pages. But I finished. No.
Thank you very much, Davide, for this very nice talk. So now we are open to questions. Any question? I see that Milton. Well, okay, so I'll start with some questions before people ask. So as I understood, so let me see if I understood. So for this zero-range process, you don't need, in order to get these large deviations of the average of the current, you don't need to perturb your dynamics in time. You just need stationary perturbations.
Yes,
so, exactly. Okay, so this is very specific, but I would like to see if, can you see from Varadhan's formula that you have some dynamic phase transition? So can you use Varadhan's formula for guessing that some model will present, or do you have criteriums to identify dynamical phase transitions in these interacting particle systems?
Not for the zero range, are you saying, in general?
Yes, in general.
For the zero, for this diffusive zero range model, you will not have a dynamical phase transition.
No, in, but general, in general, for the other dynamics, yes.
Varadhan formula is very nice. is a very nice interpretation. It's a very nice idea, but maybe it's so. At the moment, I would say no. I don't know how to really get something from there. Of course, so there is this. So you see that this density of relative entropy is affine. Then if you study this dynamical phase transition, you have to minimize with some constraint. Then essentially what is important there are the extremal points, okay? So there is this nice interpretation, I think, that so when in Varadhan formula, you see that when you have a dynamic phase transition, then your minimizer is really a non-trivial holonomic measure, probably, or maybe it's, no? Or maybe it's a measure that could have also a structure more complicated. So when you have not a dynamical phase transition, your minimizer is just an ergodic measure that is constant on time. When instead, when you have a dynamical phase transition, you could have in some cases that the minimizer is a true holonomic measure with a non-trivial path. For example, if the minimizer is a traveling wave, this should be really the case. So this is for the interpretation, but really to work with that, it's complicated because so the level three large deviation is very nice because there is an explicit form of the rate function that indeed is universal for any Markov process, but it's difficult to handle. So the answer is that for the moment I don't know how to really get from that formula.
Well, thank you. Any other question?
Okay, so yeah, I have a question. So, well, first, thanks, David, for your nice talk. I really like it. And so, also about this dynamic phase transition. So, I was thinking that if you look at moderate deviations, not instead of large deviations, probably. You recover the additivity principle, so you go to the situation of the zero range in some sense. So, do you think that this is something reasonable and maybe that will help a little bit in the analysis of try to understand a bit better this dynamical phase transition?
So you say that you could see this dynamical phase transition just at the level of large deviations.
No, maybe there is something like some sort of branching at some point. No, that if you look at moderate deviations, if the deviations are small, then you go to something like zero range like, and then you go up. You may recover some of the things, and maybe you get something of the structure emerging from that procedure.
So let's say that. So you can see dynamical phase transition for very atypical currents. So if you are near to the typical current, indeed that you have a region near to the typical current where you really don't see dynamical phase transition. For example, for the weakly asymmetric exclusion process on a ring, the external field should be enough big, but also the current should be enough big in order to see
dynamical
phase transition. So I guess that what you say it's so in the picture that I have that near to the zero of the large deviation rate function, if you develop there, you get you get information on the covariance for the central limit theorem. I would say that probably you are right. So that there you don't see that phenomena, just because this is related to very atypical currents.
And I have another question.
Moderate large deviation, really. I would say if I say yes or not, it's just like tossing a coin.
I have another question related with that. So, in in the PhD thesis of Rodrigo Marinho, a student of mine with and Patricia, he proved a CLT for the invariant measure on boundary driven, for example, weakly asymmetric exclusion process. And there is a smallness parameter that is playing around. So this result holds only if some parameter is small. And that parameter basically is the same parameter that has to be large in order to see dynamical phase transitions. So I don't know if there is a connection there, but I find it curious that the same parameter that has to be large in order to see dynamical phase transition has to be small in order to, at least for our methods, to work in order to get the central limit theorem for the invariant measure. Of course, if you want to prove the CLT for the invariant measure, there is also a exchange of limits that you have to do, that is n to infinity, t to infinity thing. This is basically what we do. We show that you can exchange these two limits. And I don't know if there is really a connection there, and I don't know if you see something like that.
No, I can repeat what I say, that on the central limit theorem, it's I'm working near, so I'm working near to the typical current, so I'm not expecting anything on this related to this dynamical phase transition, and then the invariant, so this dynamical phase transition is really a dynamical phenomena, and so it may be related to the invariant measure, and you can observe from the invariant measure, but I so it's difficult to me to say something about this. Yeah,
thank you very much.
So any other question? Well, if not, let us thank again Davide for this very nice talk. Let me just remind that we continue next week with Amin, and that you will find all information about the seminar at this webpage. I just send it to the chat, so you can follow the seminar through this webpage. So thank you all. Thank you, Davide, and see you next week.
See you, ciao.
Bye-bye.
Ciao.